Mr. Beagle, Comrade Vincent Cabrera, a strong voice for the labor movement and the people of Trinidad and Tobago. My former parliamentary colleague, Mr. Ramesh Lawrence Mirage. My friend and colleague, leader of the Movement for Social Justice, Mr. David Abdullah. People of St. James, citizens of Trinidad and Tobago, listening to us on the airwaves tonight. Particularly members of the PNM who joined us here this evening. Thank you all very much for coming out here. And what is in effect? Pretty much a historic development in Trinidad and Tobago. This meeting is a very simple meeting. It's a meeting where the people of Trinidad and Tobago, under their various leaders, have come together to talk to the people of Trinidad and Tobago. Tonight, I don't have a lot of time, but I want to focus on one particular issue. Because when things are happening, sometimes you don't understand the import of it. Let me spend my few minutes identifying for the people of Trinidad and Tobago, many of whom either have difficulty understanding the import of what has happened or what is happening, or who just do not understand how serious it is. I want to tell you about 10 things that the government of Trinidad and Tobago would have done in its short, sorry life with respect to the dismantling of the national security system of Trinidad and Tobago. You must recall, in May 2010, we had a huge crime problem in Trinidad and Tobago. But by May 2010, a significant part of the crime problem of 2008 had been dealt with. You recall, there was virtually a guaranteed news item every day about somebody being kidnapped in Trinidad and Tobago. And some of those kidnapped victims were treated in the most horrible way, scandalizing the country. And some of them were killed, brutalized, family traumatized, and the nation was traumatized by kidnapping. But by May 2010, kidnapping, as a result of a response of the security services of Trinidad and Tobago, the criminals were brought to heel, and today kidnapping, thank God, knockwood, is a thing of the past. It is not part of the reportage of the daily crime manifest. Is that true? Yes. So we dealt with kidnapping by proper security policing response. Government change. The kidnapping was dealt with because of investigations and gathering of information where you targeted the kidnappers and their friends and associates, and you eradicated them from the stage. Doesn't mean that more wouldn't come, but those who were there were dealt with, and now we're not seeing that particular crime. What did this current government do with respect to the national security system? With respect to the country's attempt to close our borders, to shut out drugs and guns and criminals, they cancelled a program that they met in place that was paid for. The people of Trinidad and Tobago had already paid for the OPVs. You didn't ask them to agree to the project and to hire OPV suppliers, and they met the things paid for. They canceled the contract at the expense of huge losses to you, the taxpayer, and then came and told you foolishness that they made money in the cancellation. You remember that? That's item number one. Number two, one of the main contributors to the destruction of the kidnapping empire was the airship that was listening and following and monitoring the criminal groups. And what did they do? They shut down the airship program and they sold the airship as crap. Cost millions and was serving you in May 2010, but in a few months of their coming into office, you don't have any use for that. Shut it down and sell it for $50,000. That they met in place, which was instrumental in contributing to the fight against the kidnappers, and which was contributing to police effectiveness in putting behind bars, even as they are there now, some criminal gang leaders. Because the government then understood that the police needed help with respect to the gathering of information. Because without information, what you call intelligence, sounds good, but it's information. Without information that can be used as evidence or to identify the miscreants, the police is blind and useless. Especially when the public, for one reason or the other, has great difficulty in trusting the police. Police can't get help from the public because people are afraid to talk to the police because they figure the criminals will know, and so on and so on and so on. So the government of the day decided you wanted a special anti-crime unit where you select very carefully, including lie detector tests, because there's serious corruption in the police service, and corrupt police are as dangerous to you as the gunman in Laventille. So you handpicked by a program of selection some of your best officers and you put them in a special anti-crime unit. Mr. Mirage just told you every serious country has the equivalent of a flying squad or the equivalent of a SWAT, special units. You have that for special purpose. These jokers in office, without being able to quote to you a single instance of any challenge in the court that SWAT was illegal, came into office using their dotish politics, where you have gazetted police officers on the street, accompanied by gazetted soldiers, two of them working together, not a single legal challenge on the book anywhere, but they call it the illegal sort. Well, if it's illegal, you had 2.5 years to make it legal, you shut it down. Shut it down, because you say it's illegal. I don't know when the police officers became illegal, or when the soldiers became illegal, because that cabal says so. They shut it down. They didn't only shut it down. They said to us, they will absorb the officers into the mainstream operations. Mm-mm. They fired 30 of the best trained officers from SWAT. Some of them involved in completing exercises for murder cases, which haven't come to court as yet. They didn't care about that. They don't care if those cases fall by the wayside, as they will. Fire them. And you have a policeman trying to become commissioner of police by telling the prime minister, fire them because they are PLM supporters. They're not PLM supporters. They are defenders of the people of Trinidad and Tobago. Your very lives depended on them. Your very lives depended on those officers who were ferreting out the criminals to save you. They fired them because they were said to be illegal or they're PNM supporters. Item number 5, they shut down the payment for informers program. You recall when they shut down SWAT? They told they found $5 million in cash in the SWAT office and tried to make it look as if there was some corruption there. You know what that was? The secret officers in SWAT, to remain secret, were being paid in cash. So nobody knew who they were. So the criminals couldn't bump them off. This government made a big thing of the money in the safe. And of course, SWAT had their informers around the country, because you know, if you don't have informers to tell you what the criminals are doing, the police is blind and helpless. So the money you're using to pay the informers, they shut down that program, so they have no informers, the police blind. So now, when anybody is murdered, shot, or you hear, it was gang related, end of matter. A lie? No. Gang related means end of matter. no gang killer being pursued. Because once the crime is called gang related, but what was SWAT doing? Getting there to find out who the killer was so you could bring the killer to heel. Now it's gang related. Move on to the next murder. It's only when a husband kills a wife it's not called gang related. That's a gang too. Right? So endless murders. No detection, and if there's no detection, no charge, no conviction. So the killing field remains attractive to the killers because they know more than you know the effect of what I'm telling you here. Because if the government blinds the state, so the state can't see, and the agencies don't exist to go after the criminals, the first people to know are the criminals. So the criminals are very aware of what the government is doing. So they feel emboldened to be more aggressive against the citizenry. The next thing they did, they shut down the repeat offenders program. So some criminals are doing their crime over and over. So you have a program against, aimed at preventing repeat offenders from being part of the operations of the system. What in God's name will cause a government to shut down a program like that? Tell me, I can't give you any rationale. Shut that down. The helicopters that are supposed to be there on standby or in use to fight crime turned into ministerial taxis. The Prime Minister certainly can't be on the ground. She had to be in the air, designate helicopters to suit herself. As a matter of fact, to be able to do that, when the Defence Force said, but you know, we're not really comfortable with this, and they weren't handing up the helicopters as taxi service, she made an attempt to put the helicopter unit under the office of the Prime Minister. We had to raise Cain in the Parliament. She backed away from creating the unit, but she wouldn't keep a bum out the helicopter. So the helicopters are in fact ministerial taxis for the Prime Minister and her associates of the cabal. They hire people who are manifestly incompetent for the jobs that they put them in the National Security Services. All of you know about Rashmi and what that meant. How could anybody in their right mind make a decision like that? Put a telephone operator with no training, no experience, and a salary of $5,000, 10 times increase to $50,000, and put that person in charge of the security system. And that remains unexplained. Eh? You are asked to move on. Will you move on from October 2010 to now 2013? The things are worse. And then, item number 9. You interfere with the police service, the Public Service Commission, where at the creation of the FIU to monitor money laundering and other kinds of crimes like that in the country. The cabinet assumed the authority of the Public Service Commission and illegally appointed a head of the FIU. And when the opposition fought that matter and got the Public Service Commission to come in and take responsibility for the appointment, for selecting the officer by public advertisement, for evaluating the officer and choosing the best, when the Public Service Commission did that, and chose Michelle Austin with 674 points. The Prime Minister vetoed that and chose somebody with 476 points. And that person is to the head of the FIU that is supposed to be independent. There as a gift of the Prime Ministerial veto sanctioned by Winston Dukeran. Item number 10. Put Chakona in charge of national security. Government has done. That brings the whole thing to a head. So they've made the national security system a laughing stock of the region, because all our colleagues in the French Quarter, in the Dutch Quarter, the United States, the British, they're all asking what is happening in Trinidad and Tobago. But you don't have to ask too loudly, you know, because you see, when you could be bringing in marijuana in containers to season chicken, and you're declaring car parts, and when the car parts open, it is a powder. And when you make a lot of money from that, you could afford to sponsor tens of thousands of toys for children in Trinidad and Tobago. It reminds me of Cali, Colombia, and Medellin, the Medellin cartel. Just give them a few things in the village, and they will tell you when the police is coming. People in Trinidad and Tobago who have questions to answer in those kinds of arrangements have an open door to sponsor a prime ministerial gift giveaway every Christmas. So the prime minister stops working every November, whatever little she was doing. And come Christmas, she's a permanent Santa Claus, giving out toys funded by people who should be talking to the police. And when you ask them, who is funding this toy largesse? They say, corporate Trinidad and Tobago. Well, we know corporate Trinidad and Tobago, if they give you a glass of water, they want a picture in the papers. But these corporate Trinidad and Tobago who funding the Prime Minister toy program, corporate Trinidad and Tobago. And why aren't they showing themselves? Because they don't want to be known to be the funders of the program. You know why? You know why? So today, the situation with respect to crime is this. The police service has not sufficient effect on gathering information with respect to serious crime in Trinidad and Tobago. In the absence of collecting information to go after the people who are committing the crime, whether it's murder, drug use, or money laundering, the police is woefully ineffective in going after these people because what little sight they had before, this government has blinded them. And that is why you're not seeing any prosecution, any conviction commensurate with the huge rate of crime in Trinidad and Tobago. And when that becomes a political problem for a government that promised you change, the government comes and lies to you nakedly. You who know things worse. The government is saying to you, crime is going down. The Minister of National Security came to Parliament on January 7th with that stupid talk. We challenged him. We showed him and we told you, we showed you the police numbers that show that he's lying to you. You know he came back to Parliament last Friday with the same lie. All those of you here in St. James tonight who genuinely feel, forget your political or racial consideration, if you genuinely feel that crime in this country is going down, put up your hand. If you are in this audience tonight and you feel more secure today than you felt in 2010, put up your hand. Yeah, not a single fist in the air, but Jack Warner is telling you that crime is on the way down. And while that is going on, he is attempting to do what Mr. Mirage just said he's trying to do, which is to amend the country's constitution. Ladies and gentlemen, many of you talk about the constitution. I'm sure most of you haven't read it, but you rely on the country's leaders and opinion makers to let you understand that the constitution is something fundamental and important. When you go to amend a country's constitution, it must be properly thought out, and the full effects of the change must be understood to those who are trying to change it. Many of us keep talking about we want to change the constitution, but before you talk about changing it, understand what you have and what you're talking about changing it to. Many of you don't understand that we have a pretty good constitution. It might require some amendments, but it protects your fundamental rights in a way that many people in the world are not protected. And when you end up in the hands of people like Kamala, who is careless, and Jack Warner, who is dangerous, thank God for the constitution that Ellis Clark and those men designed for us. So when they come to change that, I want to know first to understand what is there and what you're trying to change it to. So last Friday in the Parliament, They came with a one clause bill to create something called soldier police. And the PLM said there is no way we are agreeing to the creation of any soldier police in Trinidad and Tobago. Mr. Mirage just explained to you the difference between the police and the soldier, and why at independence, the people of this country, our founding fathers said, we want to have a police service under the Police Service Act. We want to have a defense force under the Defense Force Act. What this government is trying to do is to eliminate that important difference. And not, I keep hearing you all making this mistake. It is not about giving any precept to soldiers. Under the current law, the Commissioner of Police could precept anybody he thinks is fit. So the law, as it stands, can allow that precepting, and if the Commissioner doesn't like how things are going, he can cancel the precept. Nakona was a SRP, you know. Tim Bernard fired him on the pavement in Tunapuna. That was the end of his police career. Because the law allowed for that to happen. So it's not, the government started off by telling you that they were going to precept 1,000 soldiers. That is what they offered to you in the beginning. So having given you this idea of precepting 1,000 soldiers, with all that, the difficulty that go from there too, what they have before the parliament is not that. They are changing the law to give soldiers the entire power of the police. So police has police powers with protection under the police service. Soldiers will now have police powers without the protection that exists in the Police Act, because soldiers will fall under the Defense Act. And the police powers are accompanied by serious responsibilities on the part of the police that you, the people, can challenge in a court of law. And the police are required to carry their duties in a particular way with your protection in mind. It's not so with the soldiers in the Defense Act. And if they pass that law, the only real difference would be that there will be soldiers, selected soldiers, which is already happening, in case you all don't know. It is already happening. All they're trying to do now is to legalize it. Soldiers can now be handpicked the way they pick Rashmi and others, supposedly trained, but of course directed and instructed, held on a leash, and then let go against whoever they want. You put God out your thoughts and give that kind of power to a Jackwana or to a defeated PP government, and you will rue the day that you were so mad. Jackwana has already demonstrated to us how he will use that kind of power. We had a flood in Dago Martin. My office was out there helping people. I don't know what business it was of Jackwana. Jackwana come inside the parliament and told you that he had put people to keep surveillance on my office for the whole night to see what I was doing. Then within days of him getting that job, he got the Defense Force Chief to accompany him down to Debe to toss off some ladies and Kublal Singh off a piece of land that they were arguing over for a road. You would have seen how power would be used. But what is worse, when he came to the parliament with the bill, he spoke for 75 minutes. He never said a word about the law that was before the parliament to be changed. He spoke about everything else. He spoke about the PNM. He spoke about everything else, not the bill in front of the house. But he went on to again demonstrate to you how dangerous he is. He tried to prove that we need this change. And his words were, that is why you need soldier and police on the street together. You know why? Because the same man who don't know that Cordon Army is owed money for work done for 6 months, who had the wherewithal to take out the office of the Member of Parliament for Diego Martin West to see if he was giving aid and comfort to his constituents. He had information that there were two meetings taking place somewhere in Trinidad, one in Maraval and one somewhere to the east. But I must tell you, to understand what Jack Wonga did last Friday in the Parliament and the danger he poses to you now, you have in our constitution under section 4 and 5, fundamental rights, which are inalienable. You have the right of freedom of movement, which means if you want to go, you go, you want to come, you come. And unless you break the law somewhere, persons have to be authorized to detain you. And you also have the right of freedom of association. That's why I'm here tonight with Comrade, with Senior Council, and with you all. Freedom of association. We're free in this country to associate with any political party and with anybody.